We are actually waiting for Dr. Tahir and he's just on the way. He's coming. Theek hai, sir. Okay, I welcome you all to the interesting cases reported in different hospitals of Karachi. And the chair of this session will be Dr. Iqbal Nabi Soomro. I would request Dr. Soomro to come on stage. Dr. Iqbal Nabi is the director of Institute of Skin Health, Skin Diseases. I would request Dr. Iqbal Maimon to join Dr. Soomro on stage. And Dr. Iqbal Maimon is also a very senior dermatologist. I would request Dr. Reema Mirza to come on stage. Dr. Reema is an assistant professor at Dow University. Okay, so we start with a few cases that were reported at Institute of Skin Diseases. And I would be sharing with you some familial occurrence of rare dermatosis. And I'm sure all of us must have seen those cases. They're not so rare, but just to share some interesting facts in the end, we have put these cases on. So this is a case of a 20-year-old female patient. She's a resident of Karachi, married and a homemaker. And her complaints were she was admitted through OPD with the complaints of dark, greasy, foul-smelling lesions on the body. And the history of presenting illness is that she's a young married female with recurrent episodes of dark, scaly, raised lesions all over the body since last 15 years. At present, the lesions had increased over 3 weeks and had progressed to involve the whole body, mainly involving the upper trunk, forearm, lower legs, palms, and soles, greatly impairing her quality of life. She develops recurrent thick, foul-smelling lesions, which are of dirty appearance. On soles, there is keratoderma resulting in difficulty in walking. She also had on and off complaint of painful nails and occasional loss of nails. I'm sure all of you must be knowing what the diagnosis is. Her condition exacerbates with warm and humid climate and gets better with treatment. She had been receiving bland emollients, topical steroids, and oral retinoids during exacerbations. I would request Dr. Tahir Anis to join the panel, please. Okay, there's no significant medical history, and the drugs which I already mentioned she was on. She is married but separated. And the reason of separation is her marriage, is her disease. And she has 3.5-year-old son. Elder sister also has similar disease, but she never got treated. And father also has the similar complaint. And father is bedridden, and he also never got treated. So nothing much significant in the personal history as well. On general physical examination, everything was normal. And she was pale. That is the only finding we have. And this is the picture of the patient with multiple greasy hyperpigmented papules which coalesce to form plaques. The lesions are distributed over face, trunk, forearm, and lower legs. Scalp had seborrheic dermatitis like picture. Some more pictures. Anything that comes to your mind, can someone tell me what the diagnosis is? So some more pictures. This was a finding she had since birth. She has this cleft palate. So along with the disease, she also had a cleft palate. That had nothing to do with her disease as such. But these are some more pictures of her body and the greasy, dirty papules, the involvement of legs and hands, and the soles with keratoderma. The palms had some pits. And the nails, dystrophic nails, and a V-shaped nick right there. And nail dystrophy is there. Yes, 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 it's derriere. So histopathology, skin tissue showing papillomatosis with epidermal invagination, eosinophilic cells in stratum corneum resembling grains, and prominent granule layer, large rounded cells in stratum granulosum resembling chorons. And there was also chronic dermal inflammation seen. So on the basis of clinical picture and which is supported by histopathology, our diagnosis was of Darius disease. And this is the second sibling. She also had similar findings, the same dirty papules, foul smelling lesions in almost the same distribution. The palms had more evident pits as compared to the other sister, and the nails, and that was all. So the case number two is of, again, another female patient, 30 years of age, and she's still unmarried. And she presented to us with the complaints of dry and scaly skin since birth, and rough, brittle, and sparse hair since birth. And the history of presenting illness is a young married, unmarried female with complaints of dry and scaling all over the body since birth, which exacerbates in winter and dry weather, and somewhat gets better in summer, but she never had a clear skin. There was no colloidal-like membrane at the time of birth. She had few episodes of generalized intense redness and peeling of the skin in past. She also develops on and off pustules on the body, which gets better with antibiotic. Patient also complains of dry, brittle hair since birth, which are sparse and difficult to grow in length. She has been receiving bland emollients, topical corticosteroids, oral retinoids during her exacerbations, to which she responds quite well. But whenever she withdraws, the disease comes back. She also has complaints of allergic rhinitis and seasonal allergies since birth. And she was also diagnosed with pulmonary tuberculosis in last year, December, for which she took treatment for 6 months. And the patient is unmarried, younger sister also had similar complaint, but of lesser severity. Her parents are cousins. And so they belong to a poor socioeconomic on general physical examination, a young female of thin build and short height, cooperative, well-oriented in time, place, and person, and rest was just normal. Nothing significant in any of the journal physical examinations. Cutaneous examinations showed lesions that are distributed over face, trunk, forearm, and lower legs. Scalp had seborrheic dermatitis-like picture. And scaly plaques on the whole body, more prominent on trunk with characteristic double edge. So anything that comes to your mind? A double-edged scale? Yes, very good, Dr. Nazim. So these are the pictures of the patient. And the histopathology showed us hyperkeratosis. And yes, I forgot to mention the sparse hair. And there was, on histopathology, there was hyperkeratosis, patchy parakeratosis, uniform elongation of epidermal retiridges, granular cells, and focally attenuated focal intracellular edema, spongiosis, within the epidermis, along with exudation of proteinaceous material. And whatever we found on histology, and we also went for the microscopy of hair, which showed us trichorhexis invaginata. On the basis of the clinical and histopathological findings, the diagnosis of ichthyosis linearis circumferens was made, and which is also known as Netherton syndrome. So this is her sister. She also had similar complaints. So the reason for sharing both these cases were that one in ichthyosis linearis circumflexa, most of the patients, they have a variable response to retinoids, but in this case, the patient had a good response. And both the cases, we had put them on retinoids, and both the cases were of girls who were of their childbearing age. So whenever we prescribe some retinoids, we must be careful while we counsel our patient. And another point which I was just discussing about is retinoids are quite expensive. And most of the patients, they come to us, are they belong to a poor socioeconomic level. So we should do something regarding that. And like in West, they have this iPledge registration system, and we should build something for such patients, because most of the times, not only in different cases, but most of the time we put patients on retinoids, we don't maintain the records, we don't counsel them well in our busy OPDs, and at times we give them to married females. So how many of you call their husbands and counsel their husbands as well that it's a teratogenic drug, and how many of you religiously put them on double contraception and all? So just to highlight all this, and other points to highlight were, should these patients remain spinsters? Is our society ready to accept them, or will people ever stop stigmatizing them? And while taking history and examining these patients, I felt that their families were also so reluctant, and they were not even accepting them as their own child. So what to say for the society, but even their families were not accepting them. And what else can we do for such patients, since they have to live with the disease for the rest of their life that they're born with? So we need to proper counsel them when they visit us for the first time. We need to do their psychotherapy and emotional support as well, not only just to write a retinoid or an emollient or whatsoever. We have to be very sympathetic to these patients. We have to counsel them well. Not only the patient, we have to counsel their families as well. And we should try to form some support groups so that people like them, they come on one platform, they exchange their problems, they discuss their problems, and they shouldn't be felt left alone. So, and at times, we need to prescribe antidepressants. And whenever there's a need to prescribe an antidepressant, we should not be hesitant to do so, because one drug can help them live a better quality of life. And we should also work on prenatal diagnosis of such cases to screen the child intrauterine. So that was all from me.